What is a corpse? Hey everyone, welcome back to the Brittany Simon podcast. If you're listening on Spotify, thank you for being here. If you are on the visual, you'll probably see that I am deaf having an allergy day. I am super allergic to my cat, Indiana Jones, and though I love her with all of my heart, without a doubt, I am stupid allergic to her. So my face has not been forgiving. I've postponed filming this all day, hoping my voice would sound better, but you're just going to deal with a big plugged sounding face because I just can't get over these allergies. Now, yesterday, I took a little hit of my dab, which my brother just gifted me. So sweet. I asked my brother, I called him up and I said, "Hey, I want to try like a dab set. I want you to hook me up. I don't know what I'm doing. Help me." And he had taken, he had allowed me to use his dab set last time he was in town. And then I wanted one of my own. So he hooked me up, got me a cute Rick and Morty little set, a bunch of packets of the wax and just everything I needed to get started, torch, everything. And then I was like, "How much do I owe you?" And he's like, "Oh, it wasn't that much." So he gifted it to me, which is just so sweet because I know it probably cost like a few a few hundred dollars just given that some of the price tags were still on things. But I love my siblings. We definitely are those kinds of people that, especially if money's good or we're in a good spot, like we're more than happy to give gifts. And no, we do not expect returns in that way. We do it when we feel like we can. So last night I took this glorious hit and I was contemplating the idea of what it is to be the monster in the story. You know, I just finished season 2 of One Punch Man, highly recommend. So there's the whole Garo arc. And interestingly enough, like the concept of what is a monster ever an underdog is something that I think is interesting. Then last night, Anthony Padilla, formerly known as that guy from Smosh, did a interview with Corpse. Now, I don't watch Anthony Padilla and I don't actually watch Corpse, but I like Corpse's music. And because I was thinking about a way to talk about Corpse in terms of his fame and the parasocial relationship that exists there, it came at a perfect time for this thing to air last night. So I watched it and the conversation is heavily about that parasocial relationship, which I have been paying more attention to, obviously, because I am a content creator and because I am aware that when people reach out to me, sometimes they reach out to me through the fantasy lens they've created me, my character to be, I guess you could say. And so for me, I've been really trying to pay attention to the details in regards to that. Now, I wrote some notes and let's see what we wrote down here. It says, Corpse doesn't want to be objectified, but of course, in order to be the guy who doesn't care, he has to have someone like fans wanting him. He plays cool because the fake ones don't matter, but he's also looking for the real thing. Crazy people know that and they see it as an invite. Parasocial relationships created out of the rejection, the idol, he is always drawn in shape. Okay, so these are the notes I took. So Corpse, as you guys might not know, is a person who rose to prominence in the last year or so. And I would think that many of us maybe had never heard of him prior, but maybe had seen him on Dave, Boy in a Band, or PewDiePie, which was the case for me because I don't watch gaming channels traditionally, but I did notice that he was collabing with people that I watch. And I was like, oh, I'm going to check this guy's thing, like his stuff out. And I didn't find his content to be that interesting, but that's because it's not my specific, well, it's just not what I watch. I'm not making a hate comment here, people. I'm just saying that I don't watch his shit. And then I found out that he had music and I fell in love with his music. Now, the music is what's interesting because a lot of it is around wanting to be authentic, wanting to have voice, wanting to find people that just wanted to make shit, good shit, not sell out, you know. And then a lot of it is about girls and how they react to Corpse. And the thing that I think is interesting is when you have a person who in Corpse's situation is faceless, but has used this great anime emoji, an ode to Tokyo Ghoul, sexy as fuck, right? It automatically puts in the head of the viewer that you're someone similar. And who is the main character of Tokyo Ghoul? It's Kaneki. And who is Kaneki? He's this underdog who becomes the main superhero. That's not the right word. But protagonist and hero of the group. Defender of the group. And even though it's confusing, the darkness of Tokyo Ghoul is quite sexy and inviting. And so here's Corpse who uses this imagery. And a lot of girls love Tokyo Ghoul because of the relationship between Toka and Kaneki. A lot of people like Tokyo Ghoul because it's dark but sexy. I like it because of Shu. I like it because of the relationship between Shu and Kaneki and all these other characters. So for me, I love Tokyo Ghoul for a slew of reasons, but I was attracted to Corpse's music more because he used this imagery. And so in my head, I was like, oh, he's coming from a place of an anime watcher, which I respect automatically. Somebody who might know story, because Tokyo Ghoul is infamous for having controversies in terms of story, whether you want to go with the manga or with the anime. I personally have only consumed the anime. And I'm going to be honest, I liked it. I liked it a lot. I did not read the manga, so I couldn't compare. And I probably won't read the manga because that's just not something that I do. But I appreciate the storyline regardless. And because I got to consume it as just, this is the storyline, this is the only thing I know about it, I actually thought it was really nice. Now, with that said, one of the things that I think is interesting about Corpse's decision to sort of be faceless is that he then, I think the fantasy gets amplified. I think people who are faceless YouTubers probably actually have the parasocial relationship harder or worse than people like myself, because when they sit there and they say like these things feel uncomfortable for them, you're still just seeing a sexy image of this Tokyo Ghoul imagery, right? Because in the interview with Anthony Padilla, they had animated a figure that looked like Corpse, quote unquote, with this Tokyo Ghoul mask. And I'm not gonna lie, dude, my little 15-year-old anime heart just like, I just loved it so much. But I kept thinking the whole time, this probably isn't helping. And I know Corpse worries about two things that I think is interesting. One, being mistaken for somebody else. So like that imposter syndrome, right? And then two, hold on, I have got to blow my nose. My allergies are working up and I got to clear out my face. I'll be right back.
Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence?
Me too.
Join us on Patreon for just $1 to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just $1, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks. Bye.
So one, he's dealing with the fake facade, the imposter syndrome. And two, he's dealing with the fact that he's admitted like he's a little chubbier, or he's admitted that he does struggle with self-image, that most of the photos that people create, most of the pictures people create, fan art they create, is way off, that they don't look like him. So it's even worse. And a lot of them are sexy. It's interesting to me that he's always created to look perfect. Like his image, even on Anthony Padilla, was like tall, strong, in shape. And I just sat there and I'm like, I don't think this is what Corpse looks like. And the reason they say that is because the few things I've seen of him in terms of body language and personality does not admit this sort of lifestyle. Remember, when you're suffering from mental illness, when you're suffering from self-loathing, when you have illnesses, chronic illnesses and pain, you're probably not in fucking shape. You're probably busy sitting at home wallowing in self-pity, which, don't get me wrong, totally valid. So I do think it's interesting that the parasocial relationship with Corpse makes him vulnerable, so people want to protect him. They infantilize him a lot. Makes him strong and rugged looking, so people want to sexualize him a lot. And then, of course, makes him the monster, whether it's through his own music or through the way people portray him. I looked up some very creepy fan fiction about Corpse. Highly do not recommend Googling this. But it is amazing that people are just creating an equally vulnerable monster to attach to. And that concept is so interesting to me, whether you're reading Anne Rice or whether you're reading some sort of vampire lore, that idea of the vulnerable monster is actually, I think, very interesting. It's very interesting. And actually, I always talk about the Anita Blake series, but Laura K. Hamilton has a series named the Anita Blake series, and there's a character named Richard. And Richard is my favorite, most annoying, frustrating character of self-loathing, because Richard is trying to be a normal person, but is a were-animal. He's trying to be a part of society and not violent, but his desire, his instinct is to be this were-animal, to, you know, a werewolf, to jump into this identity. But he struggles with his desire to be sexually deviant, with his desire to be primal, with this idea, this moral compass he created for himself of perfection. And so it's like finding that balance that I think is so, so interesting. I mean, I can't help but think, oh my gosh, what is the struggle we're all feeling? Is it universal? And I don't think that it is. I think some of us are actually born into very comfortable identities, and we're good with it. I think some people also struggle with wanting to be unique, so they want to see themselves as the monster. I think some people who are even close to being a monster still see themselves as a monster. And I also think there are the real monsters. And the question is, if somebody's a real monster, do you think they know they're a monster? Or do you think it's probably a little bit of both? Some people who do and some people who don't. Because I've met a lot of monstrous people, and they're self-aware, but they'll never admit it out loud. Or I've met a lot of people who just own it so much, they're like, what else am I supposed to be? At least I'll be a good monster. And that's interesting. I used to fantasize and definitely sexualize the monster concept when I was younger. I still do. Like, let's just be honest. I still do in a lot of ways, but I know that there's the fantasy, which is a safe space to explore these ideas without actually dealing with real monsters. And then there's the reality of dealing with monsters, in which I have definitely done and regret. So you have to, like, you know, tear yourself back and remind yourself that, you know, you play with fire, you're going to get burned, as my dad always liked to say growing up. And I know when I was a rebel, oh my God, I hated hearing that. Because I was just like, what the fuck does that even mean? Like, you have to take risks. And the thing is that I learned over time that wisdom meant that that you had to acknowledge that taking risks did have consequences and you weren't going to be a pussy about them afterwards. I do think that certain people study certain lines of thinking, or they process the world and either survive or experiment with. And I sort of experience the world as sort of this opportunity to know myself better and therefore know the world better. I really, for a time, focused so much on the world that I neglected myself. And then I realized, like, I am the answer to the world, meaning to understand the protagonist in the story, you will understand the story better. And since I view myself as the protagonist in my own story, if this was my own anime, if this was my own novel, if this was my own anything, I would be the main character. I mean, I'm living my life, right? But of course, I know everyone else is the main character in their story. So every time I'm interacting with people, I'm getting this, I'll give you an example. So you ever been at a public setting and maybe it's a coworker event or maybe it's like a conference and there's a crowd talking and you're in that crowd, and then sometimes you'll talk and sometimes other people will talk, but for some reason somebody gets sort of, you know, pinned, like not pinned, but they get selected out as being the loudest or the most focused on, or you can just tell they're having a night, like, oh, this is their night. And you are the side character in their novel right now. And then some days you feel like, oh my gosh, like this is my protagonist story. Like this is everyone's focused on me. This is my night, right? It's not, you know, I feel like that's how life is that sometimes when you're interacting with people, you're always telling the story from your perspective. But as you interact, sometimes it's not about you. And so you become the side character in someone else's story, which allows humility to continue and arrogance to be checked. But you still should have enough pride in who you are as a character to even have a story. I've met so many people who think they're constantly the side characters in a story. And I'm like, my homie, don't you have pride? Where's your pride as a character? When I watch an anime and I understand that they're trying to focus on X person as the main character, and then there are B characters and C characters, it's really interesting to me how sometimes they do highlight certain B or C characters and you get to know them a little bit more. And sometimes I say to myself, you know what? I'd love to watch a series with their perspective. You ever see that too? This is what's happening every day in real life. I think I find the infantilization of corpse to be the most interesting thing. They do this with a lot of celebrities, but men in particular who show any form of vulnerability get babied by women. And I think that's very interesting because in some ways you'll have other men who are on the other spectrum who hide all their feelings, who say, this is why I don't show emotion because I'm constantly infantilized. And I see this in both spheres. I remember one time, you know, because I'm a very dominant personality on my channel and I don't show a lot of vulnerability like I used to, or I just don't show it very often. Well, one day I showed a moment of vulnerability, and then somebody signed up for my Patreon and he said, you would always seem so strong, but then when I saw you vulnerable, I felt a need to reach out. And I was like, why? And then I realized over time that was like his kink, where he finds vulnerable women and then he, you know, pays for things and then wants like physical contact in exchange. And I had met with him and it was so funny talking to him because he was so old, like he was in his 70s. And I was like, are you a grown man or not? But he wasn't. He dressed like he was in his 20s. He tried really hard to be young. He was in denial that he had aged. And I just, you know, it was somewhat attractive to me. But it was one of those things where I tried to respect him as an equal, but I couldn't, because in so many ways I had the upper hand. Like in so many ways in that story, I was still the lead protagonist. And I was in control. I think a lot of the times when we hear about these situations, we think that because I'm the one who showed vulnerability, I'm constantly vulnerable. But that's not the case for most of us. And so in those situations, I think the person who's most in charge is the person who knows not to sell out for money, or knows that they have a foundation of values, or they have some sense of dignity. Because one of the things I found most unattractive about him was that he only wanted to reach out because I was vulnerable, because that was his kink. It was about him. And that's not real. And I think that's what Corpse feels when all these women, these cat girls, right, are all trying to infantilize him, be there when he's vulnerable. But what about when Corpse isn't vulnerable? What if another side of Corpse is extremely dominating or aggressive or doesn't need you in that way? What is he to you then? And so the objectification of the parasocial relationships, the desire to be the monster, the desire to see yourself that way, or the desire to even admit that you're the monster, is sort of a call out. I feel like Corpse's music is trying to call out and say, I am a person who is other, and the fantasy you have about taking care of me isn't going to look so great in 10 years when we possibly have children, or when my life goes a certain way. As somebody who dealt with suicide and dealt with anxiety and dealt with panic attacks and dealt with a lot of mental illness issues, and somebody who's better myself, somebody who I know, like, I look at Corpse and I sit here and I guarantee you, like, I think he's a good person. I think he has a lot of goodness in him, but I've never... It's been a long time since I've seen a content creator be so openly vulnerable and I think misunderstood by the core of his audience. And a big part of the reason why I think I can see it and other people might not be able to is because I'm not a fan of his work. Like, I'm not a fan. I'm a fan of his music, but I'm not a fan of his YouTube stuff. So I don't ever listen to his personal anecdotes. I don't judge him on sort of the, the facade that he's pushing when he's working, because I don't know how many times I have to say it, but when you're a YouTuber, there's definitely always a shtick you play into, you heighten for videos because they're funny, but like, you're sitting there thinking like, oh, I have to be funny. You ever see a PewDiePie video and he's like, man, I don't even know if this video was good? Because as a content creator, when you know the camera's on, you are always thinking about that, especially when you know viewers are going to take and splice what you say, especially since people fantasize about you so hard. Like, one of people's favorite fantasies with Corpse is the boy-on-boy love that happens between him and some of the other male content creators. And by the way, this is my favorite part of growing up in the later years of like being a millennial, but seeing how things have progressed. I love watching men be comfortable flirting with other men, because there is like a little sense of anime boy that is attractive, but they are not the same men that I know that are super straight, or the same men that I know that are like alpha all the time, or like blah 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 all the time. You know, they're different kinds of boys. They're called like soft boys, but soft boys have an opportunity to be more than that. But to say that there isn't a genre of soft boys on the internet who have dyed hair and piercings and black nail polish, and they're men, they make a lot of money, but they're still like, if they had to like have a fight with like my dad or like one of my brothers who's like focused on becoming, you know, physically aware, you know, intensely body focused or primal, it's a different energy. But what's interesting is I'm wondering about the balance of these things. So, okay, in order to examine that you might be the monster, i.e. other, and people might not understand you, right, that comes from a place of like objectification. The monster gets objectified in, I think, two ways. One, always being scary, or two, being secretly vulnerable. But the monster can be all of those things and none of those things, right? The monster can be a being who's trying to be their best, and their best might be, well, producing work as a monster, right? We talked about this with the Sully thing, I think, in the last podcast or the podcast before that. The other part about being a human monster that's interesting to women especially is their desire to mother and take care of and be maternal. And I think that sometimes in these relationships, if the monster gets better, it is no longer a monster, then what is he? But also for himself, we've created this identity around this attitude. And if you lose the attitude, you got to create a new attitude. I think that was the hardest part of my recovery of mental illness, was that I had learned to function kind of like a functioning alcoholic. I was a functioning mental ill person. And then I realized over time, like, I wanted to be a functioning healthy person. So what was I going to do to get there? It's very scary, because you have to almost have a new identity. I mean, what is one of the complaints that I've gotten over the last 10 years on YouTube is, wow, Brittany, you've changed so much from person to person. Yes, because I'm always growing and I'm forcing myself to be my best version of myself. And I know I'm not there yet. Like, I know I'm especially physically not there yet. I know I'm not there all the way. I want to be better, and I know there's more to reach out. But I remember identifying as the monster at a point in my life. And I don't identify with that anymore. And it's so weird, because I almost miss her. Like, I miss the part of Brittany that was self-loathing, and I kind of miss the part of Brittany that was struggling. But then I remember that I at least have my memories and then I can move forward with those memories. Like, those memories weren't good ones, but man, I can't help but respect the hustle of that Brittany. Because she really learned how to function, even if it wasn't smooth and it wasn't perfect. And then when shit got worse, she picked up her pieces and kept moving forward. Like, sometimes I forget, like, Marcus called me the other day, my brother, as many of you guys know, like, him and I are the two queer kids in our family. And when Marcus calls me and he goes, Brittany, I think I forgot what it's like to be sad. And I was like, oh, blessings. Like, this is, it's, and it's so funny because we both found it being in the middle of nowhere, working with animals slash plants slash nature slash, you know, just like humbly. And that's how we found it. I don't know what your journey is going to be. I don't know what Corpse's journey is going to be, but there's something that happens in the life of a monster when they stop being a monster, but it's not a monster that's really done anything horrible. And I think, okay, so that's where the conundrum is, right? If you're a monster who's just like a depressed, suicidal, self-loathing kind of mental illness feeling monster, it's like, it can be, it can change. But if you're a monster who like rapes children or like goes around massacring people, that's a different sort of monster. And then those monsters are not the same as people who might have been a hired gun in a country where like that was normal. That's even different in and of itself. And that's what's crazy about being a person is like, you have to not only pinpoint who you are in the story. Like, if you were in Harry Potter, right? Which character would you be? Like, I know I'd be Slytherin. Girl, let's just like be real. I would be 100% a Slytherin for a slew of reasons. But like, who are you? And then how would your trajectory go? When I watch Attack on Titan, like, who do I most identify with? Like, I think about these questions all the time. Who are these tropes, these stereotypes we identify with? I know that we're all unique. I know on the you know, just our individuality alone is beautiful. Watching my friend die and watching his body lay on the bed made it so clear to me that like being a human being is amazing and living a life is beautiful. But if you can't identify who you are in the story, I think that's why life feels so hard, because we don't want to admit when maybe we're not the greatest person. I just watch these videos all on YouTube of like scammers who try to like get you to hit their cars and then say you hit their car. And it's amazing because these are real people. These were babies at once. And then they grew up in whatever situation and their brain, their life, their culture informed them that the best way to survive is to go around scamming people on the freeway. Amazing. Crazy. Corpse, when he looks at himself, I'm sure feels very unique and also like a clone. Like, because I know people who create art, like I can see it through it. People who create a sort of a specific depiction of themselves, I feel like I understand the trope or the place they're coming from. And this is good. This is better, helps us understand each other. So my biggest, how do I say this? Hold on. So as unique as Corpse is, there are a billion corpses in the world, but those billion corpses have to interact with other corpses. But instead, what they often interact with is crazy cat girls. So that's why it feels crazy, because that's how I feel. That's how everyone I meet feels when they're a little too weird for the world. Because there's a difference between being a weird person and a really weird person and then like a creepy person. But I think a lot of people think they're weird because they're different, because they like anime or something. But the thing that makes a person different, I think, is how you problem solve. And so far, what I've seen from most people is that most people do not problem solve in a unique way. Most people problem solve in the way that's been given to them. So we're not creating new ideas to problem solve. And so I don't think you'll be able to problem solve your monstrosity clearly until you sort of hone in on these skills. For me, again, I use the comfort of art. I think people have depicted through fiction or movies or storytelling the struggles that many of us feel. But of course, the things that I read, the things that I consume would be considered just like grotesque or awful, or people would cancel me, or people might think I'm a crazy serial killer. I mean, pick up a Poppy Z. Bright book and tell me that Poppy Z. Bright doesn't have one of the most fucked up minds in like literature, but is also very interesting. I was thinking of just like Anne Rice. And if you pick up, you know, her Sleeping Beauty series or even just read Interview with the Vampire, there's a lot of fucked up storylines in that story, but it's also beautifully depicted. And sometimes when we go to fantasy, things that are very extreme, it just allows us to play with these ideas. What does it mean to be a monster? Is a vampire a monster, or is a vampire somebody who's just being their best vampire self? A vampire has to drain blood to live. So is the vampire really a bad guy just because they're a vampire? And it's one of those things where, you know, I don't blame the shark for being the shark. I don't blame the bear for being a bear. Why are we blaming a vampire for being a vampire? And I think it's because when these things are depicted, we give them human challenges. Like, okay, you remember in Twilight how everyone was upset that Edward was like 108 years old and Bella was like 17 or whatever? Again, we're holding Edward to a human standard. And it just doesn't make any sense, because the whole point of holding him to a vampire standard allows us to play with ideas that we can't play with as humans. There's no real story that's going to occur, though it could, where a 108-year-old and a 17-year-old are dating in terms of the human world. It could happen, but traditionally, young people don't marry people on their deathbeds, 108 years old, right? Unless they're gold diggers. And in that case, you know, Anna Nicole Smith, Papa Bless, you know, all that stuff. It's one of those things where I'm not saying these things don't happen outside of an organized sort of monetary beneficial exchange. You know, that makes sense. I'm saying, do these things happen in just like nature without, you know, something crazy like that happening? Well, if they don't, then how do we have that conversation? Plus, the 108-year-old in our life is going to be old and wrinkly. The 108-year-old vampire is just going to look like a 17-year-old boy. And that's the whole point, is that when you dive into these fantasies, you have to be open to these things. Like, I think it's interesting that Corpse talks about, like, choke me, like, you hate me, but you love me. That's very interesting, because, of course, when I talk about BDSM, people always talk about how domestic violence is an issue and how women are already being beaten by men. Why are we promoting these things? And again, you're only looking at the statistics, or you're looking at a bunch of people who don't have the context for what consent is to, you know, or what abuse could look like, or what abuse, like, violence is such an interesting idea because it comes in so many forms. I guess what I'm trying to say is, oh my God, I feel like I'm totally mumbling. I feel like this podcast is going to be a 0 out of 10, but what I'm trying to talk about is that serious realization that the monsters are on a spectrum, and that the good guys are on a spectrum. And I think there is a way for them to overlap that makes sense, that makes everyone sort of the anti-hero in the end. I think for me, obviously, I love the anti-heroes the best because I think they're the most human. But I also know we need the Gryffindors in our life. We need people who are always going to be those heroes you can depend on. And at the same time, we always need our villains. A good villain is just as important as a good hero. And for me, I can't help but see Corpse as somebody who views himself as a monster and probably has good reason to, even if it's just personal, right? Even if it's not objectively anything bad, it's just how he feels. And then I see a future in where Corpse doesn't suffer so much, but it's not going to come from the parasocial relationship of women infantilizing him on the internet. It's gonna come from people treating him like an adult. And I understand from the males around me that when women infantilize men, it doesn't feel good, especially in relation to their desire to be a provider or their desire to be considered somebody who can protect their spouse. In the same way that when we infantilize women, it doesn't feel good that people view us as little girls, or that people view us as weak, or that people view us as something that can't protect itself. It's very different than viewing us as someone we want to protect. I want to protect my male counterparts as much as my female counterparts. And when the situation is correct, we lean on each other for different things. You know what I mean? I guess I am curious to see what happens in the next 5 to 10 years. I really hope Corpse finds peace with his existence. I really think he can. And I think even though he suffers so immensely, there's a lot of joy that can be had actually internally. Remember, Corpse's fame or his money is so unimportant to his true sense of joy, inner joy. I know a lot of people will dismiss this. A lot of men get really resentful of Corpse's fame and say things like, why do people even like him? If you don't understand it, don't pay attention to it. Go spend your life doing something more valuable. But for me, the thing that I can't help but want to examine is why people like Corpse. And I can't help but feel disgust that it seems to be a desire to infantilize him, which I think would make me feel like a monster. Sorry, one more note. I just want to tell this story because I think this is the real reason I probably thought about this. My sister and I were talking about wearing COVID masks in public. And I don't wear them unless I'm asked to. If people ask me to wear them, I'll wear them. If it's a private business, I'll wear them. But I personally don't wear them. I am very claustrophobic. Well, I should say I'm pretty claustrophobic. And so I have PTSD in relation to my assault. And I had told my sister and I were talking this weekend, and I was saying that, you know, sometimes when I'm wearing my mask, it really fucks with my head because it feels like I'm being assaulted again, you know, and it feels like someone's trying to cover me up. And she goes, well, you know, people get special exempts from wearing a mask, and I think that would count. And I said, what? No, I ain't gonna be no pussy. And she's like, what? And I was like, look, I don't even like wearing a mask in general. On principle, I don't like wearing a mask, but I will not wear a mask because of my PTSD, because that would be for me like weakness. And I refuse to let my assaulters continue haunting me. So I was like, fuck no, I'm going to wear that mask. And I'm going to be so good at wearing that mask. Even if I get close to getting triggered, I'm going to be good at wearing that mask. And so far it's been okay, but I have to like count down the seconds when I'm wearing it in stores and be like, you know, we're just going to wear it for a second and then we're not going to be wearing it. And it helps me not have a panic attack. But it is one of those things where, funny enough, it would make me feel disgusted with myself if I allowed the memory of that assault to stop me from being able to wear a mask. And it's a lot about pushing myself, and it's a lot about living up to my own sense of how I see myself. I see myself as a very strong and capable person who has been the bad guy and the good guy, who's been the anti-hero, who's been a lot of things in her story, who sometimes has made poor decisions and good decisions, and somebody who's gotten better. But the whole point of my existence is to get better and to find, you know, and to continue along that path of like inner peace and inner joy and connectiveness with the world and my family. And so why we do things, I think, is so important. How and why we view ourselves is so important. Yeah, I think that's all I want to talk about, you guys. I'm just very interested right now in this idea of like, what is a fantasy? What is reality? Why do we put people on pedestals? And then why, when we know parasocial relationships are real, why do we make the mistake of continuing them? Why do we objectify the people we love, or in our heads love, to the point where it drives the people we love insane because they know we don't know them? So when we objectify them in this way, we're hurting them. But then he needs that parasocial relationship to have a career because those girls ride on his every tweet in order to feel connected to him. I don't know. It's very strange. I've been really pondering. Okay. Can't wait to hear your thoughts. Thank you so much for watching. Please help us suck the teat of YouTube by liking, subscribing, and turning on the notification bell. I know I've done it for a bunch of channels that I watch, like Cody Ko and Abba and Preach, and it's so helpful. Just get a little ding on my phone to be like, yo, your people have uploaded. And I'm like, oh, damn, okay, gotta watch my people. You know, it makes me feel good throughout the day to catch in with the few content creators that I do love to watch. So please check that out. Please check us out on Spotify if you're interested. And I will see you when I see you. All right, bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while I'm in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Done.